I changed my title on my talk, since it's the speaker's prerogative, as the pitfalls of using machine learning optimization. I just want to tell you a few problems that I hope that you will take with you and work on it, actually. Initially, I was being very, grandiose and wanted to talk to you about four things, but I'm only going to talk about three things. And if you're interested in the last one, which is optimization problems with tiny feasibility regions, come talk to me afterwards. So the first one is instability of embeddings. Many of the machine learning-based optimization methods, or as Pascal called it, proxy optimization, use some form of embedding or encoding of data in vector spaces. And we heard a lot of that this week. And in fact, 2 years ago, basically to the month, IPAM had a workshop on this that I know Xavier was involved in, and I was here giving a talk on how you can use embedding and spaces of embedding in deep reinforcement learning to solve the problem that you're not omniscient, and so you have to discover parts of your network. For example, you want to discover people who have sexually transmitted diseases, or you want to find certain aspects of your network that you do not have, and so who would you go query, kind of a thing. Now, since then, we have thought a little bit more about this node embedding, and Stephanie talked about this yesterday, right? So you have a graph. Graphs are oftentimes thought of as high-dimensional data. And so what you want to do is you want to basically reduce the dimensionality of that data, and oftentimes we embed the nodes into a lower-dimensional space, usually Euclidean, because we like Euclidean. But if you happen to have a graph that has trees and has stars in it, hubs in it, then perhaps you want to do hyperbolic embedding, since hyperbolic spaces are better at containing stars. When you think of a star, think of Beyonce, for example. And so node embedding is oftentimes used for common tasks, whether it's classification, link prediction, clustering, et cetera. So one of the questions that we asked recently with my student David Liu was, how sensitive are node embeddings to graph perturbations? Why is this important? Is because, alas, you're not omniscient, breaking news, and the data that you're getting is incomplete and noisy. And so, of course, usually your initial question is too high level, and so you need to modify it to be able to examine it. And so we changed the original problem as, how sensitive are your node embeddings, to how does the embedding of the degenerate core change as the nodes in the periphery are removed and the graph is re-embedded. For those of you who don't know what the degenerate core is, there are these terminology. One is K-core, which is the maximal subgraph of nodes with degree at least K, and the degenerate core is the largest K in the graph, so the max K-core. And so why should you care about the degenerate core and its stability? Degenerate core is where a lot of the information is in this network, and we, among others, have done studies that this degenerate core is not a clique. It actually has hierarchies in it. If people in the degenerate core leave, then your online social network could disappear. And I really like the last work, which it showed that to be a star, you need periphery nodes, right? So you, without the existence of these periphery nodes, the supporters, you're not going to have stars. And so you should care about the degenerate core. And so we were interested in the stability of the embeddings of nodes in the degenerate core, which you can think of it as a dense subgraph in a graph. Yeah.
So the degenerate core is the K core for the largest K?
Yeah, exactly. And we're interested in the nodes that fall into that. And so we looked at this evaluating of this stability the following way. Basically, what we would do is we'll shave the graph and re-embed it and see what happens to the degenerate core. For those of you who have looked at graphs or thought of it, this is the very famous Zachary Karate Club graph. So at k equal to 0, what I'm showing you is it's embedding in a two-dimensional space, and we're using node2vec, which is a very popular skipgram based embedding of nodes in a graph. And the scale in all the plots in the bottom are all the same. The blue nodes are the nodes in the degenerate core. And you'll see that as we move along and as I shave the periphery of this graph, what happens is the embeddings of the degenerate core change a lot, right? And so why would you care about this? The reason being is that these embeddings are then used later on in optimization and other kinds of tasks. And so really, the embedding is a relative thing. It is not a absolute position of, oh, well, Tina in the social network belongs right here, right? It really depends on the data and you're getting, and the data that you're getting, alas, because you're not omniscient, it's incomplete and noisy. So we came up with this measure of peeling instability. Later on, I'll talk about different notions of instability. Yeah.
In the previous slide, yeah. Is the degenerate core changing or are you fixing that? Because the degree definition of the degenerate core depends on the degree of the node. The degree of the node depends on the orange nodes too.
Yeah. So the degenerate core for example, this one is k equal to 4. And so what we're tracking is actually where were the degenerate core here at the original?
Great. So you fix that set.
Yeah. Yeah, as you go along. And so we have this measure of peeling instability, where basically every time I embed and I have my degenerate core, I measure the pairwise distances between the nodes in the degenerate core. And as Elias mentioned, it's the original graph that you got without it peeling it. And then we find the density for it, the distribution for it. And then our measure of instability is to measure the earth mover distance between how much the pairwise distances between these nodes that supposedly are important to you change over time. And so the first part of what we did is all empirical. So we picked a bunch of data and a bunch of algorithms. The first thing you need to think about is why these data and these algorithms, right? So we pick the data to span the following space. I want graphs that vary in their degenerate core, that k, the max k in k core, I want them to change. That's the y-axis. And the x-axis is a measure of entropy. It goes from 0 to 1. And the closer to 1 you are, it means that the degenerate core was well connected to the outer layer, to the periphery, versus closer to 0, it means it was less well connected. And so this is populated with both real and synthetic graphs. One of the synthetic graphs that I, synthetic graph generators, which I really like, is BTER, or they call it Better. It came out of Sandia. It's block two-level Erdős-Rényi random graphs that are able to both capture the degree distribution and the triangle distribution of your graph. So in terms of the methods, I really like this survey paper from the Google Graph team. And so they break all this stuff on graph embeddings into supervised and unsupervised. And I like unsupervised. I don't like teachers, even though I'm a teacher. And I don't like attributes. So we're only looking at the shallow embeddings, right? So what we are doing is we're picking methods from these different different boxes. And we're seeing how these different methods perform as I shave and embed, right? And so we found three patterns. The first one was that the degenerate core embeddings are sensitive to the removal of this specific K shell, and I'll talk about that. Then the other thing which we observed is that the degenerate core embeddings for Erdős-Rényi random graphs, these are, you can be GMP or GMN, and the Barabási-Alber random graphs are stable. So Barabási-Alber gives you scale-free degree distribution. And the third one was that as the periphery is removed, the degenerate core pairwise distribution becomes smoother. And I'll show this in pictures. So the first one is a point of instability. Here I'm showing you the last FM who follows whom network. And what you can see is that basically between K9 and K13, something happens. Right? So the distribution on these pairwise distances of these nodes that supposedly are important changes. And then when we look at all these different methods that we looked at in, on the shallow embedding that follow the taxonomy that the Google Graph team came up with, we see that, oh, all of them say there is something going on between K11 and K13, right? And I'll talk a little bit more about that and what that is and why you should care about it. In particular, in terms of these out-of-distribution problems that Stephanie talked about yesterday. The other one was that we saw that Erdős-Rényi and Barabási-Alber networks didn't have that issue. that shift. And in part, it was because that the degenerate core constitutes a large portion of the entire graph. And so if your degenerate core is a large portion of your graph, then your embeddings will not suffer from this peeling instability. The one thing that we did see is that as the periphery is removed, the pairwise distribution between the nodes and the degenerate core becomes smoother. So here I'm showing you the English Wikipedia network. And so as K is lower, like K1, et cetera, you see lots of bumps. But as K gets bigger, K49, you see less bumps. And here you're seeing it against all the different methods that we tried under the shallow embedding. And we're using the dip statistic, which is the closer it gets to zero, the more unimodal your distribution is going to be. And so what is it that's contributing to these peeling instability? What we saw is that it's correlated with the edge density. So as you peel your nodes, you get to a point where your edge density no longer is what you expected. And so here I'm showing it to you in terms of the Facebook graph between K equal 70 and 71, and the last FM between 15 and 16. And here are some of the features of the subgraph and what you'll see. And then we did a small study on this, like a regression analysis, in terms of what are the features of the graph that really matters. Size here is the number of nodes in the degenerate core versus the number of nodes in the graph. And really, it's edge density that is the key aspect of things. And one of the things that we were able to prove, obviously, you're not able to prove anything on real-world networks, but on Erdős-Rényi networks, we're able to show that when you're doing this Laplacian eigenmaps, which is a very simple approach of having the Laplacian matrix of an Erdős-Rényi graph, and then basically doing a form of singular value decomposition on it, the best and worst possible embeddings based on your loss become less distinguishable as the edge density increases, right? Some theoretical backing, but not much. And of course, what you can do is you can try to say, look, I care about peeling embedding, and I'm going to add a loss term to my original loss term to penalize for unstable embeddings of the degenerate core, because supposedly these people, I care about them. And so one thing that we came up with was this first order proximity, that if the degenerate cores are close to each other in the higher K, I also want them to be closer to each other in the lower K. And of course, whenever you change somebody's objective function, they're like, oh, well, how does it do in downstream performance, especially since nowadays we only seem to care about prediction accuracy, and we're doing well with addition of this this other term. So, yes?
You're making it more stable, so the standard deviation should be smaller? Is it the numbers in the table? So your stable procedure, the standard errors? So which one is your procedure? Stable, right?
Yeah, the stable is ours.
So stable, the first one, the base, has a smaller standard error compared to stable. No, but generally they're similar, with the exception of the first one.
Yeah, so some of these, in terms of the data itself, you know, it could have some peculiarities on the data itself. Now, the one thing is that, I like your colleague, Alessandro Madri, had this work about the trade-off between robustness and accuracy. And so when I'm fixing where you're putting the degenerate core, I may be also screwing up accuracy if I really care about accuracy, right? But the notion is that really if you want some notion of stability for these embeddings, it's not that Tina resides here. It's that Tina, relative to the data I saw, may fall within this epsilon radius, right? And then you should go forward with that as opposed to a particular coordinate, right?
Is this regularizer easy to compute? Is this loss in the term?
Yeah, it's not a big deal.
Do you not have to somehow simulate the embeddings on the graph with the K-shells removed?
Yeah, but removing the K-shells is very easy, right? So you can remove the K-shells and then do the embedding and see where they fall, and then you can fix that, right? It's not that, yeah. So this is what, so there is peeling instability, right? So if you happen to get bad data, then your embedding is going to be bad, then that's going to affect down the road what you're doing. There are, of course, other forms of instability, right? So for example, what is the role of negative sampling? So in a lot of these skipgram-based methods or methods that look at context to be able to find an embedding, you say, okay, well, I'm going to update my gradient based on what's in this window. And like one of the methods that they use in terms of negative sampling is a ZIF distribution with an exponent of 3/4. It does well experimentally, but it's not clear why. So there's this notion of what you choose to be your negative samples that can also affect the embedding of where you fall, right? And this is something that we're looking at now. And of course, there are lots of other notions of instability. One of the works which I really like is by Sesh. He's a professor at University of California, Santa Cruz. So the first paper was a PNAS 2020 paper where they prove that complex networks have rich structure. And if you're mapping it into this lower dimensional space, it's impossible to capture triangle density well. And so there's this notion of perhaps maybe we should have multi-course embeddings where depending on the type of node that you're embedding, maybe you should use different dimensions. And then he had a paper last year in the SIAM data mining conference which showed that depending on what measure of performance you pick, the existing embedding methods can perform very badly. So a lot of the embedding methods, and what I showed also was on link prediction or graph generation, what he said was, okay, well, a lot of these embedding methods say if you and I are close in the graph space, as in geodesic distance, then you and I should be close in this embedding space. And so he said, well, if that's the case, a lot of the community detection or discovery algorithms look at this notion of closeness. So if you and I are close in the graph space, as in you're a part of my community, how many of the nodes in this embedded space that are close to me are also part of my community? And then all of these methods that have very good AUC on link prediction, et cetera, do very poorly. So they're not able to capture that local structure very well, right? So things to think about when you do use an embedding method, given these issues. And with my student Leo Torres, who's now at Max Planck Institute for Mathematics and Sciences, we looked at not looking at the spectral properties, but looking actually at the geometric properties of the data that you have. And we observed similar things as what Sesh had seen, in that some of these methods really rely on having a lot of triangles. And if you do not have a lot of triangles, then they're not able to do well. And that's protein-protein interaction networks, for example, don't have a lot of triangles. And so maybe looking at the geometry as opposed to the spectra of these graphs, as in looking at simplicial complexes, is a better idea to look at. So that was what I was going to say about the instability of embeddings. Again, there are lots of different ways that an embedding can be unstable, and the embeddings that you're getting, and especially since oftentimes model selection is not performed in terms of, I don't know, 128, 2 to the 10, 2 to the 8, it's always some power of 2, that how much do you need that to be true is a key component of your ML-based optimization. So the next one that I'm going to talk about is the emergence of topological shortcuts, which is what the model learns is not what you think the model learns. In fact, in all of the talks this week, I never heard anybody, maybe one person, maybe Phoebe talked a little bit about this, but this notion that if I am using an ML-based optimization, should I actually probe that ML model that's doing the optimization to see if it's learning what I think it's learning? Right, and you've seen many of these examples. Like, for example, there was a recent one that was highlighted on Jon Stewart's show at HBO on Sunday, where they're trying to predict skin cancer. And what the machine learning model learns is that images that have a ruler in them are more likely to have skin cancer. Right, and this type of thing we have known for a long time. These are two philosophers. This is 1992. Right, we had known this. The U.S. Army wanted to see whether they can say whether a tank is in a picture or not, basically, they had a bunch of images that when it was tanked, it was like cloudy. When it was not tanked, it was sunny. And basically, they learned whether the picture has shadows in it or not. And so this notion of actually probing the ML-based optimization is something that would be interesting to look at. And maybe I just don't know, and people are looking at this. So it needs to be approached with caution. And so this is recent work that we have that's coming out in Nature Communications with a big group of people, but Ion, my student, is the first author on it. And what we wanted to do was drug discovery, right? So a lot of people have worked on this, where you have drugs and you have known proteins, and you want to see which one will bind with which one else, right? And so we have, we're all about pre-training. We have an unsupervised pre-training, and then we have a whole supervised module to be able to do to predict whether a particular protein will bind to a drug or a natural compound. And one of the things that we found was, depending on your experimental setup, you could get very different results, and your data itself. So we have three different experimental setups. The first one is what we're calling transductive. This is where I have seen all the nodes during my train graph, right? And I just want to predict whether there's an edge between two nodes that I saw in my training set. And here, what I'm showing you is our method, Deep Purpose, that was published in 2020 in Bioinformatics. It's from Jiming Sun's group. And the configuration model. The configuration model is one of the simplest models you could ever want in real life. You have a bunch of nodes, they have some degree, and you're trying to make a graph out of the degree sequence that you've been given. And so we see that the configuration model is doing very well. I don't need all these other machinery. Then when you look at the semi-inductive case, where one of the nodes was in my training set, but the other one wasn't, and I'm still trying to predict the link prediction, again, I see that the configuration model does extremely well. So it's only on the purely inductive setting where the two nodes for which I'm trying to predict do not belong in the train set is where the learning-based models are doing better than the configuration model. And this is important, and we're calling it the emergence of topological shortcuts. And so when do these topological shortcuts happen? You should know about them, because otherwise, why are you burning the planet down by learning all these parameters? And it really has to do with the class imbalance. In the paper, we call it annotation imbalance. It's going to Nature Communications. But that basically how you pick, again, those negative samples, which was also highlighted back in the original, in the first part of the talk, is extremely important. Because what happens is basically what your model is learning is picking on the degrees and of your nodes and not looking at the actual molecular structures that are making these bindings for you. And so we have these things we call network drive negatives, where you look at the number of hops between, for example, here we have proteins and ligands. And so for us, for example, for the training, was we used 7 hops as negative sample. So whether this connects to that is 7 hops away, right? And again, these are bipartite networks. You have proteins and you have drugs and natural compounds. And so you really need to look at your data to try to see what are the right and the distributions of who's negative with whom to be able to come up with the right negative training set so that you don't have this emergence of topological shortcuts. And this is an area that I feel like it needs to be studied more. Again, cracking open these ML models to see, did they actually learn what we want them to learn? So the last part is adversarial machine learning. How many of you have heard about adversarial machine learning? Many of you, excellent. So the first one is man-in-the-middle attacks. We've heard a lot about shortest paths. So what if you have somebody out there who wants to attack shortest paths? You have a populated area, you have a popular destination, You have a network, it could be a traffic network, whatever else, and this is the shortest path, but there's an adversary who doesn't want you to take the shortest path. He wants you to take this other path because he has a toll or some other way that he can make money. And so what he can do is he can change your data so that you believe that there's a lot of traffic there, and so you're going to go this other way. And so this guy then becomes rich because you'll take this other way. And so can an adversary force a specific route to be the shortest in the graph that you have? This problem is called a forced path cut. We labeled it as that. So you're given a graph with nodes and edges. You have edge weights. These are the distances. There is a cost associated with removal of an edge. There is a path P star from the source to the target node that the adversary wants you to take. The adversary has a budget. It's not like they have resource constraints. And the edges can be removed with total cost less than B. And so can the adversary force this P star to be the shortest path? And this is work with my student, Ben Miller. So, after I'll talk about this in details, but after we did the paper, one of my colleagues with her student, they use it for some traffic systems. These are different cities. This is LA, this is Chicago, San Francisco, and Boston. You pick different source and targets, right? And you're like, oh, well, the adversary wants me to go through this particular route. Which edges would the adversary cut within his budget? And one of the things that was interesting in their work was that the edges that the adversary would cut would not always be near the path that the adversary wanted you to take. So this is LA, this is up here, this is Chicago. Some of the edges that they would cut would be far away from the path that they wanted you to take. And the details are in the paper. So the questions that we asked were these three: can an adversary efficiently find an optimal attack for a target path, edge, or node? Are there approximate solutions that one can find? And is there an observable trade-off between time and quality of solution? So the first one is that the forced path cut is an APX hard problem. It maps to the three-terminal cut problem. So three-terminal cut says, given a graph and three-terminal nodes, what is the minimum cost set of edges whose removal would disconnect these terminals, right? I want to get rid of these in this particular graph. And this is an APX hard problem, and it cannot be approximated in polynomial time within a factor of 1.2 unless P is equal to NP. So we modeled this as a set cover problem. You saw a lot of this kind of a bipartite graph this week. I believe Bistra had a lot of these in her talk. So you have paths, those are your elements, and you have edges, and those are your sets. And covering an element cuts a path's edge, right? And so that's what you would like to do. And so there are lots of different ways of doing this. You could use a greedy method, or you can use a linear programming method. And I'll show you results on both of them. And both algorithms guarantee a solution at most a log factor larger than optimal. This is work that was done by Vazirani back in 2003. So what is the path attack algorithm? So you have the optimizer. The optimizer says, I'm going to cut the cut and then sends it to an oracle. The oracle says, OK, if you cut that, then you have to add, this is the newest shortest path. So then that gets added to the constraints, and round you go until the red path, which is the attacker's path, is what you get, right? And this has no ML-based learning in it. We're using Groby, et cetera, et cetera. And so you could do this on weighted graphs or weighted graphs. So for unweighted graphs, you're cutting the edge. For weighted graphs, you're increasing the cost. One of the things that we found, which was interesting, is that so both of the approximation algorithms yield similar costs. So this is wall clock time, and this is cost in reduction ratio from the baseline. And but one of the things is that if you have a grid-like network or like a lattice, then you're making the attacker's job a lot harder. Right. So again, it's not that, oh, my algorithm will work on any kind of data. It is the master algorithm. But that actually, if you have obviously more redundancy, then you're making the attacker's job harder. And then on the weighted graphs, this is the results is similar. Again, the Achilles heel is grid-like graphs, right? Which for example, it would be like Manhattan. It would be more difficult to attack the Manhattan transportation network than, let's say, Boston. So we are looking at ML-based optimization. One of the things that for this kind of routing problem, the node embedding doesn't make sense so much, so there's edge embeddings. And that still, the stability issues continue. And if you're doing path embedding, which also in like this supply chain optimization problems, you would like to do path embedding, then the question is what is, so which paths do you want it to be close to each other? Is it that they overlap? Is it that, and by overlap, what do you mean by them overlapping? Is it just the number of nodes? Is it that, or is it this specific edge that exists, et cetera, et cetera? And then you could do constraint generation, because again, the space is very large, so you have to have some constraints. And so we've been looking at Dijkstra's algorithm, A star, because I like it, where the heuristic is defined by the embeddings, and also the neural algorithmic framework. But what we've found is that with the third one, it needs a lot of tailoring. And then, of course, you can replace then the optimization method as opposed to calling Groby. You could do some supervised learning model, which would predict which edges to remove, or a reinforcement learning model that what you would learn an optimal policy. And that was actually what I talked about 2 years ago, right, where you are picking nodes to query. Here we will like to remove the edges. So the space is much larger than nodes. So if you're thinking about edges, the space is much more massive than nodes. So it's been a harder problem to fit with an ML-based optimization than, for example, looking at nodes and extending which nodes to query. Yes?
So there's this family of combinatorial problems called reconfiguration problems, where you have some combinatorial constraints, an initial solution, and a target solution. And you're looking for the, you know, say a short sequence of transformations of the initial solution such that you maintain feasibility and eventually arrive at the target solution. Have you thought about the connection to that? Because here, like, you remove one edge, one edge, one edge, for example, and you want to say a small number of them to get to the target shortest path.
Yeah, we did look at some. We didn't know that was his name, but we did look at some methods. Like, for example, this edge has a very high betweenness centrality, or these set sub edges have high betweenness centrality between the source and target, and they do not reside on the attacker's path. But finding the betweenness centrality is costly. And so it was kind of like, okay, pushing the buck down.
Because what's known there is this general class is p-space complete. So independent of approximation, space is an issue. And here you seem to have the approximation part, but you need to generate this path, et cetera. So it seems like reconfiguration, because you have to go around the fact that there's exponentially many paths and so on. So maybe there's like a deep connection to that, it seems.
I'll look into that. That's great. Thank you. Actually, how that maps to like what graph properties we can look at, right? Because I will have to look at some graph property, right, to measure. So something that would be easily computable to use as a guide. This is what we found, right? So there's the fact that you want to, so you have an attacker. The attacker wants their path to be the shortest path. And so you can't solve it in polynomial time, but there are good approximation solutions for it. And there is a trade-off, in particular if between time and performance, in particular if you have lattice-like graphs, it's a lot more difficult. And one of the things that we're looking at right now is this notion of How would I defend against such an attacker, right? So one of the things that will be interesting in this ML-based optimization is that, okay, you're trying to do ML-based optimization in a space where there are adversaries, right? And this is what the adversary does, and this is what you do. And so how would you want to defend against this kind of an attack on the shortest path? And so we're looking at differential privacy-based approaches, where basically you're going to lie to people about the costs, right? And this is not new. So the US government, when they had the first GPS systems out, right, they were jamming some of the information that was coming down. There are obviously ethical issues in terms of lying to people. And also, you know, you really just want to lie to the bad guys and not to the good guys. And so we do have a objective function that we're working on right now of how we optimize it. But I don't have it here because it's work in progress. And then the next thing that I wanted to talk about in terms of adversarial ML here, in particular because I like graphs, and not just the structure of the graph, but also diffusion on the graph, right? So perhaps we are, God willing, at the tail end of this pandemic, and so it's not just the structure, but whatever is processing on top of it, right? So here I'm showing you different graphs. This is T0. This guy gets sick. So there could be a structure where as T goes to infinity, you have more infections. Another structure that as T goes to infinity, you have fewer infections. So the question was, how can an attacker manipulate the structure of the graph to increase or decrease the impact of diffusion? And so you can think of it this way, where I have this graph, I have my nodes, and there's this targeted subgraph. And what the attacker would like to do is to infect those people. A particular application for this would be, for example, cybersecurity, right? So the attacker gets into your network, and they want to get to your mail servers, right? And so, but they don't want to be detected as they are walking your graph. So we had this work, yeah.
So your application is to help hackers find the network server faster?
Yeah, well, look, you have to think both ways.
Okay.
I mean, there are adversaries out there, right? There are tons of money that's being spent on cybersecurity, right? So you need to think about how would the attacker do, hence like the red team and the blue team, right? So, yeah.
I mean, I guess I have a related question, which I guess the next step would be to think about how to design the network to be, like, optimally robust against such attacks.
Yes, I do have some results on this one.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. So it's like adding another, basically, a game, or another min-max on top of this. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. And that's why, like, in the previous segment, I was saying, like, well, how would one defend against such a thing, right? And so, well, the way that we're doing there is basically lying, basically saying adding some noise to what we're telling the public. So, yeah. So targeted diffusion. You have this malicious actor, and they can modify your graph to achieve two goals. One is to maximize the diffusion. So if you have WannaCry or Randomware or whatever, they want to spread it in a targeted subgraph, but they do not want to be detected when they are on the other part of the network. In particular, if you have, for example, a computer network, not all of your machines on that network are equally protected. So I can get in through a back door, not be detected until I hit your mail server, at which point I own you, I own all your passwords.
So you're assuming here the source of the attack is fixed? Random or something, but not in the control of the attack.
So here, the attacker can get in on any of the nodes, right? So I'm not saying that the attacker specifically, like, will come into the network through Tina's machine. Yeah, any node can, and in fact, if they can, actually, I'll talk about this in a second. Yes, you'll see that in a second. It's part of the objective function of where the attacker starts, in a way. Okay, so the setup is I have a graph, it's connected, it could be weighted or unweighted, it's undirected with no self loops. We oftentimes don't like loops. I have n nodes in it. I have the adjacency matrix representation of the graph. There are lots of other representation of the graph, but here we're using the adjacency matrix because we're interested in diffusion, and there's a link between the largest eigenvalue of the adjacency matrix and the epidemic threshold. So you have these eigenvalues of the adjacency matrix from the largest to the smallest. And so the problem definition is that what the attacker can do is change who talks to whom. So that would be the attack vector, where basically they can change the adjacency matrix, right? So that's what the attacker can do. And so the first objective of the attacker is that if the virus, as Bistro was asking, if the virus starts at the particular subgraph that they want to attack, then obviously they want to create an epidemic. They want everybody to get it. So that's what I just said. If the virus starts outside of GS, then you want it to reach S. So here I want to increase the normalized cut, as opposed to minimizing it as an attacker, between the subgraph I want to get at and the rest of the graph. And the third aspect is that I want to limit the harm to the other part of the graph that is not my targeted subgraph, because I don't want to be detected early, before I own you and all of your resources. So I want to increase the sum of the eigenvector centralities of the node in S. That's what I want to do in the targeted subgraph. So then the objective function is as follows. I want to have an adjacency matrix so as to maximize this equation. I want to increase the path capacity in the targeted subgraph. I can do that by increasing lambda 1, the largest eigenvalue of the adjacency matrix. I want to increase the eigenvector centrality of the nodes in S because I want to end up there. And then I want to increase the normalized cut between S and S prime, or the nodes that don't belong in S. And of course, I have some constraints. I have a budget in terms of how much I can change the eigenvalue of the adjacency matrix. And I want to have a valid adjacency matrix, right? I cannot have an invalid adjacency matrix.
In the unweighted case, the changes amount to just minus 1 or plus 1.
Exactly.
Or at edge. Then in this case, it seems the eigenvalue stuff are just proxies, but you could write a binary linear programming formulation and say exactly I want to minimize damage, maximize whatever, right?
Yeah.
Then is this problem somehow easier? Because you use the eigenvalues to approximate the impact.
In the unweighted?
Say in the unweighted, yeah.
So in the unweighted, I wouldn't say it's easier. It's like the techniques are more well known. We do have a paper coming out in the SIAM data mining conference about how would you not necessarily do the attack, but how would you do these kinds of epidemics on weighted networks where you have weights on the edges, which you would use a slightly different approaches. So basically what we do here is we make sure that every element here is a differentiable function so that we can use a gradient-based approach. So we use the Rayleigh quotient, we use the power method, et cetera. We have we get a function that then we can use the gradient on. And so it's fast and no problem. So we ran this on a bunch of different data sets. And so this is what I'm showing you is the budget in terms of how much you change the eigenvectors. And then the y-axis is the number of infected in the modified versus the original network. And so the purple ones, you want it to be low. You don't want many people to get infected. And then the red one is the target that you want to be infected. And then we ran this for, there are many, many different diffusion processes. So for example, initially there was this thought that COVID-19 is a SEER model, susceptible, exposed, infected, recovered. Now we found out that you can also be susceptible after that. But so you can do an SIS, SIR, SEER, or a random waste model. And then going back to what you were saying, you can, with these kinds of things, try to prove that, okay, well, what are the necessary conditions for a successful attack? given a particular budget. So given an instance of this targeted diffusion, and I have this impact on the, this I of GS is the impact on the particular subgraph that I want to cause harm with. And so I can estimate it by using the birth rate and the death rate of a particular virus. And we have a paper coming out in terms of these epidemiological models of cybersecurity viruses, these kinds of persistent, what is it they call it? Advanced persistent threats, they call them. So you can you could approximate it, and then if you have an upper bound on how much of an impact you have to the true one, and you have the degrees of the nodes in S, you can increase them. Then what you can show is that in order to have this much impact, the attacker has to have this much budget, right? At least this much budget. So you can't try to change your network if you're a state actor, you could change your network such that you could make it harder for attackers to attack your network. But this includes basically increasing degrees of nodes. So you could prove these kinds of things. And we can show it in simulations in terms of what is going on and whether this is this bound makes sense. So basically, the application, the way to think about it is cybersecurity. And so can somebody do a targeted diffusion to attack part of your network? And we showed that, yes, they can do it very efficiently. And so the question is then, like, how would you defend against your network? And so this is one thing that we found. But again, like, not everybody perhaps can change their network in terms of, like, buying machines, right? Buying servers are costly for many people to be able to increase the cost. So I talked about these three pitfalls of using machine learning-based optimization. This week, I saw a lot of really nice overview plots or overflow or like these kinds of flow charts where they go through some kind of embeddings. And just watch out about the instability of these embeddings, in particular because unlike, for example, when you work on data that you know which distribution they come from, you're working on a particular instance of a data set that somebody gave you. Right, and they're often can be incomplete and noisy. We found these emergence of topological shortcuts in these machine learning models, and so it would be interesting to look at whether these machine learning-based optimization models are actually learning what you think they're learning. And this has to do with this notion of one scenario that we saw was really how you pick your negative samples matters with these kinds of topological shortcuts. And then the last one is, if in fact these ML-based optimization methods are going to be used in real life, right? You write a grant for NSF, you say broader impact, right? My tool is going to have a broader impact. That's why Tina's grandmother should pay taxes for me to do this kind of work. Then they're adversaries in real life, right? And so if it is an ML-based model, then it's like turtles all the way down, and you need to worry about what adversaries can do. And I showed two tasks that we've been working on in terms of what adversaries can do. There's another task in terms of how would you attack a vertex classifier, and a lot has been done on that as well. So basically, you have a network, and you wanted to see like which accounts are fraudulent and which ones aren't. And let's say Tina doesn't want to be detected, and so what can Tina do to fool your machine learning model? So on that note, I know I am ahead of time, but thank you very much, and I'm happy to answer any questions.